Hello everyone, I'm Kaya from EAMS LAB Japan. And firstly, I would like to thank the organizers for offering this great opportunity to share our recent progress on AI navigation with ArduPilot and OpenKAI. I have to yell at my Chinese translation. 大家好，首先我要感谢主办方提供我们这次的机会，让我们共享一下使用 OpenKAI 和 ArduPilot 以及人工智能导航的最新的一些进展。 So first, what is OpenKAI? Does anyone knows, ever heard of it? Nobody? Okay, thank you guys. Thank you. You will receive a t-shirt next year. So OpenKAI is our open source framework. The aim is to control the unmanned vehicles easily, tightly with AI technology. So we suppose OpenKAI is running on a company computer. Collaborating with ArduPilot. And you can see that we have several basic modules as well as computer-intensive modules from sensor, vision, network I/O to the more than neural network, flam, tracker, detector. And OpenKAI is not only used in real-time application, it's also been used in the data center, providing offline modules that, for example, we can use OpenKAI for data augmentation between model training of neural network. So currently we have incorporated numerous cooperative libraries like Cafe, Lolo, Google Cartographer. You can easily use this in the navigation of a UAV. I will show you details later. 首先, OpenKAI 是我们公司开源公开的一个框架，一个库。 那么问题是把最新的这个人工智能技术简单的应用到无人机的导航控制上面来。那么 OpenKAI 内部提供很多基础的组件，有这个图像处理、各种传感器、驱动，还有这个网络。那么还有一些就是计算量比较大的，比如 SLAM， 还有人工智能神经网络这样一些组件。那么您可以简单的把最新的技术应用到无人机导航当中使用。 So currently we provide many three supported and tested platforms. The NVIDIA Jetson TX3, ASUS Thinkboard, and Raspberry Pi. And of course, it's without GPU. It's not necessarily the expensive the better. It's totally depending on your application. For example, if you just need a QR tag navigation landing, a Raspberry Pi is free enough. If you need something, some serious AI neural network, then NVIDIA Jetson 3 is the only choice. We also provide the driver for modern sensors like Intel WebSense, Veriline, Latitude, ArduPilot, Bandwidth. If you follow our GitHub typing, we find that someday there is a support for a new sensor, and after several days, it's just gone secretly. Which means that we have tested that kind of sensor in the real field, and we find some kind of serious problem, and there's no hope to solve that things in the future, then it becomes a history. 首先，我们现在主要提供支持三个平台，那么主要是由英伟达的 Jetson 系列，还有华硕的 Thinkboard， 那么当然还有树莓派，那么开发主要是在 PC 有或者无 GPU 都可以这样的平台上进行。 那么同时，我们提供驱动，支持很多最新的这个传感器，包括英特尔的 RealSense、 Veriline 的 Lyre， 还有 Latitude 等公司的产品。那么有时候，如果您一直跟踪我们的 GitHub， 你会发现，我们经常会提供新的对接、新的传感器进行支持。那么过几天以后突然消失了，这主要是因为我们在现实的这个场景中进行过测试，然后我们觉得这个款传感器可能不是太可靠，不适用于工业级用途，所以我们会把它消除掉。So, firstly, I would compare OpenKAI with the famous Rolls of the Rolls. Firstly, Rolls is designed on the philosophy for multi-part robots with a reliability the first concern. Imagine, for example, imagine you have a humanoid robot with multiple parts. On each part, there's an MCU controlling the servo, and all the parts communicating with each other over the message passing interface. So, for example, if your left hand is broken, then the left part, your right hand, right leg, and your body can still move. However, OpenKAI is designed for totally different purpose. Well, it's a modern design of unmanned vehicles. For example, we have a quadcopter, and ordinary there are up to two kinds of controller. On the low level, there's things called control dynamics. At high level, there's for example, NVIDIA Jetson controlled AI computation. In this case, we do not necessarily need the message passing interface. On the contrary, we need something more simple, something more efficient to make it faster and easier on the debug, because we are looking for the application industry world. So OpenKAI, the most different part of OpenKAI growth is that OpenKAI is a single process, multi-thread architecture. Every function is organized as an independent C++ class, which runs in the independent thread. And all classes access each other by a single memory space. There is no messaging pass interface, so there is much, much less overhead. So the merit of ROS is that it's powerful, it's a measured system. So, however, it has a big overhead. But for OpenKAI, it's lightweight, it's easy to get started because it's purely writing C and C++. The merit of OpenKAI is still under the early stage of development. There's absolutely no doubt, no Google yet. 那么首先我们与这个有名的ROS形象比较。 那么ROS主要是设计于就是人形的游戏系列，一个机器人可能有多种部分组成，每一个部分有它自己的控制芯片。 那么芯片之间通过一个 message passing 这样的一个接口跟互相进行交流。那么比如说这个机器人的右手被弄掉了，这个时候剩下的部分，左手和它的其他的腿部仍然可以进行工作，以保证它的稳定性。 但是 OpenKAI 它的设计思想是，主要是面向现在的无人机器。大多数情况，这个机器上是有两个控制器。那么在底层呢，我们有像 Pixel 这样控制底层的音箱。那么在上层，我们用这个一个 SOC， 比如 NVIDIA 这样的 SOC 进行一些计算量较大的工作。那么在这种情况，我们并不需要太复杂的这个交流、这个通信系统，我们需要一个更简单、更简单。 运行速度快、简单维护的一个这个方法，所以 OpenKAI 设计最大的设计思想在于它是一个单进程多线程的一个系统。那么所有的系统可以非常简单、非常漂亮的分成一个 C 再加一个库，每个库用它自己的这个线程进行执行。那么实行效率要比 ROS 高很多。那么 ROS 的好处是它是一个很成熟的系统。 它已经有很多这个工具和构建，可以供大家直接拿来使用。那么 OpenKAI，那么 OpenKAI 的那个好处是它非常轻，并没有太多余的东西。那么它的缺点是仍然在这个开发的初始阶段，并没有任何成熟的这个工具供大家使用。OK。
This slide, for this slide, I think there will be a lot of argument, but as part of our best knowledge, this is our true impression in delivering an industrial-grade solution to our customer. So OpenKAI, ROS is great from the idea to somewhere after the POC stage. But if you really want to use ROS to deploy a 24/7 system to the industrial user, it's going to be a nightmare. In the contrary, OpenKAI's design is a little hard to use at this moment. However, OpenKAI is simple, it's simple to deploy, it's simple to debug, so it's much more practical to be an industrial solution. So we have lots of reasons to recommend OpenKAI. Here I only summarize that as OpenKAI is made for ourselves. We are the industry solution developer in Japan. And OpenKAI, of course, is open source, so everybody is testing in the real world on a weekly basis. 那么这张图是我们自己的感想，可能会有很多人反对，但是我们自己的感觉是 ROS 是一个很好的一个作为早期证明你的 idea 的一个工具，你可以很简单用它实现一些比较酷的 demo。但是如果你是想用 ROS 进行这个工业级 无人机系统部署的话，那将是非常复杂的一个过程。因为 ROS 如果想把 ROS 作为一点做速度快的话，需要很多追加的冗长的工作。那么 OpenKAI 是我们自己为我们的自己客户提供工业级支持这个目的所进行开发的。 那么我们每个星期都会去真正的这个工业级的现场进行测试，所以在北京测试方面，我们有自信说 OpenKAI 肯定会胜过 ROS。So I'm going to give you one extra example to support my idea is that you know the Baidu Apollo autonomous self-driving controller system that is open source. Apollo was designed based upon the ROS. However, if you see Apollo 2.0, you will find that about 2/3 of the code is rewritten by Baidu to meet the real requirements from the real world. 那么我在这里多加一句介绍。那么来，这是我的观点。比如说，百度的 Apollo 自动车驾驶系统也是开源的。那么 Apollo 一开始是建立在 ROS 系统上面的。但是如果您看一下 Apollo 2.0 的话，你会发现大概有1/3的代码会已经被改写过，因为 ROS 本身的构架不足以支持这个无人驾驶车在现实世界中的一定的应用要求。So let's say example to introduce the architecture of OpenKAI. For example, we have this copter flying about the human on the mountain side. The copter has to identify the human by AI system and track the human and deliver something to the target. In this case, OpenKAI, there are about 8 modules in OpenKAI. The vision is just reading color screen, and EAM detector here is a deep learning system which consumes a lot of CPU power. And tracker is it's just tracking the result of the EAM detector, tracking bounding box. And then the result of the tracker and EAM detector is consumed by autopilot. So they are running in a totally different speed. Like the vision, we can expect up to 60 FPS, but for the AI part, we only can hope for like 10 FPS. And for the tracker part, we have another open source library from our company that achieves like more than 60 or even 100 FPS on single SoC. And finally, we use autopilot module to combine all the results and decide the velocity position controller controlling signal and then send to the pixel or the mapping module via the serial port. On the other IO, we send the position information of the target to the internet, to the cloud system, over the Maverick and UDP. In this system, all modules are run in a different time scale. However, if we assume that we have a multiple CPU system here, the typical case on hardware is that they are organized very efficiently on different threads that are allocated to different CPU core. Because OpenKAI has much less memory dependent workloads, so OpenKAI can consume the arithmetic logic core of the SoC more efficiently. Like for example, if you have a system doing the same function, the system with ROS and the other one is a system with OpenKAI. If you touch the SoC, you find that the one with OpenKAI is slightly hotter, which means that it generates the execution cost more efficiently and consumes the hardware more efficiently.首先，那个我们用这个简单的例子来介绍一下 OpenKAI 内部的构造。比如说，我们有一个这样的应用，是无人机在上空飞行，寻找地面上的目标，然后锁定它进行跟踪。那么这样的情况 ，OpenKAI 里面大概有八个这样的这个库。那么比如说 Vision 这个库是从摄像头那里取得图像。DNN Detector 这是人工智能生成网络进行运算，进行目标识别分析。那么 tracker 这个库是进行跟踪，那么最后我们把这个结果放到 autopilot 这个库里面，变换成这个坐标，进行坐标系变换，然后发到pixel 那边进行真正的即时控制。那么这样的情况在 OpenKAI 里面，我们可以为每一个组件定求的计算量定义不同的执行速度。那么在一个多内核的这个CPU 系统上，每一个组件会被安排到不同的 CPU 内核上进行执行，这样可以更有效地利用有限的硬件资源。那么我们打一个比方，比如说我们有两个系统，一个用 OpenKAI， 一个用 ROS。那么您会发现，执行同样的工作，这个用 OpenKAI 系统的这个散热量会稍微大一点，因为 OpenKAI 会更有效地利用这个计算资源，减少这个内存上面的一些调用。So let's get started with how to use OpenKAI. So there are maybe two ways of using OpenKAI. The first one, the most used one, is using OpenKAI symbols with dot keys. It's just a JSON-based config file. So you put that on the first argument when you run OpenKAI, and that's all. This is okay for most of the users if what you need is already existing and supported in OpenKAI. However, if you have some kind of new sensor that you want to incorporate and use that one in OpenKAI, you may have to add your own class.
那么，这里我们来介绍一下怎么样使用OpenKAI。主要有两种方法使用OpenKAI，一个是写一个这个JSON格式的设置文件，那么执行时把它放到OpenKAI的这个第一个引入里面就可以了，很简单。那么这种情况主要是，比如说你用的这个传感器已经在OpenKAI得到支持，这样这就是足够了。还有一种情况是，你有一个这个全新的传感器或者你想写完全独自的系统，这种情况你肯定要写一个完全独自的一个。First, let's start with the most simple one. Our aim is to define a camera, the case file, and show the stream of the camera to the screen. So now in the case file, each object corresponds to the class in the OpenKAI core. And for here, because we want to use camera module, we define the class name as the camera. The underbar means that this module is executing the independent thread. And we define the properties like FPS, desired FPS, device ID, and resolution. Then, when you click the OpenKAI with this config file, it will automatically read the configuration and then set up for you. And everything here, between the auto FPS from and auto FC2, everything between those two functions will be executed in the desired FPS. If the system cannot meet your requirement, then it will just do less. 那么，首先我们介绍一个最简单的这个 OpenKAI 的一个例子。那么是我们定义一个这个摄像头，然后在屏幕上显示摄像头内容。这种情况，我们只需要在 case file 里面定义一个 object。 那么 object 上面的 class 这个项目呢，实际上相当于 OpenKAI 里面的一个库的一个名称。那么我们定义这个名称的时候，如果前面也下线，那么代表这个库是运行在完全独立的线上面。那么您可以同时定义你想所需要的各种的这个设置。那么在执行时呢，这个设置会被自动的设置，自动的读进 OpenKAI 进行设置。然后 OpenKAI 在 OpenKAI 里面，您可以指定你想用多少多快的速度进行处理。 那么所有的处理写在这两个函数之间的处理，都会根据您的指令进行安排进行运算。如果您的系统达不到这样的速度的话，那就OpenKAI会尽可能的执行的快一些。Another important thing, the case file is that you can define the dependency between multiple objects. For example, now we want to do this. We want to fly a UAV on top of a disaster scene, and we want to use the AI system to identify the targets on the ground. So now we define a camera, as we just did, and we define a yaw detector. Yaw is the famous AI library. And we link the camera module into the vision base of yaw, and then when this particular file is executed with OpenKAI, the yaw module will link the instance of the vision and consumes the frames from the vision class. That's all. 那么在我们再一个稍微复杂点的例子，就是，比如说我们现在想做这样一个事例，就在这个在上空，在线上的上空飞行无人机，然后同时在图像上自动的寻找这个各种各样的地面目标。那么这个时候，在OpenKAI的这个 case 文件设置里，我们只需要定义一个相机，然后再定义一个用这个YOLO这个库的人工智能识别系统。那么同时把这个相机的名称写到这个库里面。 那么在执行时呢，这个YOLO就会自动的把这个相机这个数据流连接起来，在这个每一帧上面进行这个图像识别，寻找这个地面目标。The third one I'm going to use is how to add a new class. It's very simple. Basically, you can do whatever you like as long as it inherits the thread-based class. So
in own class, you include thread-based header file, and then you inherit this the architecture, and you fill up the two virtual functions, init and update. In the initialize functions, you are giving interface to this configurable, and you can read the configuration properties from JSON and do the initialization you need. And then, update function, just we saw in the previous thread, there are two key functions, auto-fds-from, auto-fds-to. Do anything you need to do between these functions. And they will be key on the desired FDS. And last, you have to register your own class into the module C++, basically just adding this one line to add a module, so that OpenKAI will recognize your new class, and when you execute the JSON file, it will be read, and the instance will be made and launched.
那么比如说，你需要定义一个新的驱动程序来用你自己的这个最新的算法或者是传感器，那么这个时候你可能会需要自己定义一个自己加入的库，那么这个库很简单，你只需要继承了 threadbase 这个库就可以。 所以在使用两个函数是必须要写进去的，那么第一个是 init 函数，那么在这个函数里面你会得到一个 keys 一个指针，那么你可以从这个指针里读取设置文件里的数值，那么还有另外一个函数 update 函数，update 函数你可以把你自己的这个需要做的处理写到这两个fds from fds to 两个函数之间，所有写到这之间的处理都会按照你所指定的这个速度 fds 来进行执行。 那么最后，你只需要把这个你自己的这个库加到 add module 这个 macro 里面就可以了。So next, we are going to introduce several projects based on ArduPilot and OpenKAI. 那么下面我来介绍几个真正我们真正在进行测试的这个项目。First one is classic obstacle avoidance. We did this 2 years before in Saitama, Japan. For example, the UAV is flying and it comes to the forest. There are trees in front of it. It has to stop or when it identifies any obstacle in front of it. And also the copter flies, there's a pole in front of it. For this purpose, you just have to define the key style like this. You can grab this file from GitHub. So we define the AP copter depth engine class in the case file and define the bounding box. The orientation is the same one that is used to distance sensor message on Mavic. And we define this bounding box based on the spring coordinate so that if OpenKAI detects anything in front of it, it will send the distance sensor message to this copter. 这个是非常简单的，非常系统。我们是在两年前在奇迹线进行了一个测试。那么我们用一个双模式摄像头，安装在飞机前方。它如果这个发现前方有障碍物的话，会给这个操作方面发送这个麻布的麻布的命令。The second example is a QR tag precision delivery. So OpenKAI is reading the QR tag, and once it finds any tag on the ground, it will start to send the message to the deep fog. We have the demo on the right side, as you can see, the copter flies above the ground, and it descends to a certain height, and then the copter will find the tag on the ground and start to match in position. You can define multiple tags in the OpenKAI.his configure file. And if the copter, if OpenKAI detects multiple tags, it will send the position of the marker based on the order they are defined in the keys file. 那么第二个这个意思是我们用这个二次元的这个跳心码进行了一个精确的投放这个展示。我们在地面上可以放多个这个二次元的跳心码。 然后在执行时 ，OpenKAI 会把执行码的位置发送给 TikTok 方面。那么在发送这个包的时候，它可以准确的投放到这个跳心码的上方。那么您可以定义多个跳心码 ，OpenKAI 会根据您定义的顺序，优先的把第一个跳心码的位置发送给 TikTok。如果第一个没有的话，那就会第二、第三个这样下去。
third example is use OpenKAI for non-GPS navigation. In Japan, you have a lot of bridge, high bridge, expressway, and many of them are built 50 years ago, so they need a careful investigation. However, we have lack of manpower, so there's a huge demand for the autonomous investigation system without any human intervention. One goal for this kind of system is that it has to fly under the bridge, and there's steel structures, concrete on top of it, which blocks the GPL signal. In some root station, we do have the GPS, but we cannot always look for the best condition. We have to make the system tolerate the worst case. So in this case, we use a LiDAR with a Google cartographer, and we convert the position from the sun system into the mapping GPS, and then consumed by the TikTok site. This is our mascot, Mario, holding the Veriline LiDAR. It's a huge pleasure to use the $15,000 LiDAR in the initial test. Therefore, we will use the Intel regions for the initial test to confirm everything's okay, nothing's going crazy. Then, in the end of this month, we'll put the real Veriline into this field test. 第三个例子，我们介绍一下在这个桥梁下面飞行的情况。 那么在日本，我们很多这种高架的桥梁，大多数是建于50年之前。那么现在到了一个需要检修的时期，那么在检修时期，我们需要在桥梁下方飞行，桥梁上方的这个桥梁的金属构造和水泥构造会影响 CTS 的这个稳定性和这个信号强度。所以我们假设我们没有任何 CTS， 只是用这个LiDAR 进行导航。那我们现在正在尝试用 Google Cartographer 和这个 Veriline 360度旋转 LiDAR 进行导航。我们把它周围的这个形状，然后把这个坐标传送给作为一个 CTS 假的一个 CTS 信号传送给 ArduPilot 方面，对它进行控制。那么因为这个 Veriline 这个 LiDAR 实在是非常昂贵，大概需要1万5千美金一个，所以我们一开始先用比较便宜的 Intel Ryzen 相机进行初步的测试，等问题等这个问题之后，在这个月底会真正把这个 Veriline 装上，在现场进行测试。 So this is the real example that using Intel RealSense with OpenKAI on the non-GPS navigation. You see the cockpit RealSense to identify the age of the pilot and use that as a reference and then convert that into GPS position. And so the cockpit set into loiter mode. It tries to stay in the position even if there's no GPS signal available. You can see our stuff here trying to drag it. But the copter tries to stay against the external noise. 那么这个演示是我们用这个 Intel RealSense 进行的一个简单的测试。我们在飞机上用 RealSense 这个相机，我们在飞机上用 RealSense 相机识别那个桥梁柱子上的那根线，那么用那根线作为一个参考器来得到一个坐标，然后用这个坐标把这个坐标变换成假的 CTS 坐标发送给 ArduPilot。 然后您可以看到，即使没有 GPS 坐标，我们对它这个进行拽这个飞机，那么这个飞机到自己的位置变化了，那么它会努力的去回去保持它的原来的这个位置。So this is example we just introduced our just ski. This is a very interesting example. This test is done in Fukushima province in Japan. You know, after the 3.11 earthquake in Fukushima, a lot of the place near the nuclear plant is busy and there's no people living there. And then the place becomes a paradise by like by hawks. Now the place is safe. However, there are a lot of wild hawks taking place of the place. So it's very hard for people to get back to their home. So there is a project to scare away the wild hawks from the living area, the resident area. However, occasionally there are still some hot spots in the place, so it is very hard for human beings to scare the wild hawks. So a drone is one of the most practical solutions for this situation. we use drone to identify the wild hog and follow it. Because hog, pig hog is very smart. If you do that several times, they will know that there's something dangerous, so they will not come again. Here we use OpenKAI with a camera, a yaw detector, open tracker to track the hog, and we convert the position into the position control, speed control via PID control class, because we do not have exact height between the copter and the target. So at the moment this test is done, we didn't have a good neural network model for hogs. So our staff trying to act as hog for our test. 那么这个是我们在辅导县进行了一个测试，和模拟是追踪和下属的这个野生野猪这样的动物。因为在三幺幺大地震之后，辅导县和辅导核电站旁边的区域，由于放射性物质的原因，人民著名都已经撤离。现在这个区域已经建得非常安全，但是因为有很多野猪、野生动物在那里徘徊，所以还是不适合人类的居住。那么我们的目的是把它，把这个野生动物所驱赶出去。 因为现在还有一些偶尔会有一些这个放射性的热点，所以用人去驱赶不是太现实，所以我们在尝试用无人机自动的锁定和锁定这个野猪这个目标，在它上空盘旋。那么也不非常聪明，追它几次之后，它就不再把这里来了。This
is the safety landing. So we use the AI system to segmentate the system. The green part is safe part. The red part is for construction. Structure area. So if you have to land somewhere, the OpenKAI will drive the copter into the green area, make sure it's safe landing in the emergency landing. 那么这个例子是在机身端实时进行这个对地形分离的例子。那么我们分类的结果展示在这里，绿色的部分是非常安全的地方，红色的部分可能有建筑物，然后蓝色是天空。 那么当这个飞机由于某种原因不得不进行坠落处理的时候呢，我们会用最后的这个动力让这个飞机坠落到绿色方面，从而保证地面物体和人的这个安全。So
I'm running out of time, so just a little bit introduce our future roadmap. We are going to try and make OpenKAI going gradually deeper, lower into the flight control, combined with low level dynamics control. At this moment, we are, for the visual recording machine and the chasing, we are already able to use DNN to identify targets and chase. For the next stage, we are going deeper, like use a small neural network in ETF to identify abnormal vibration and copter, and make a forecast of the error and make it land before the failure. In the near future, it's possible to have. In theory, it's possible to have one unified DNA to combine everything together and control the copter more wisely, more smart. 这我们是展现一下我们将来的计划，是用 OpenKAI 逐渐的基底层的飞行控制。那么现在我们使用 ETF 做这个传感器的这个处理。那么将来我们可能用一个人工智能的网络越来越深，把人工智能网络越来越深的进入到这个飞行。 姿势控制的这个理念，在不远的将来，我们理论上我们有可能有一个完全统一的这个人工智能深层网络，控制飞行放射的所有部分。At last, I would thank the EAMS LAB being the lead and great sponsor for this project, and there are also several startups and universities that are starting to use OpenKAI. And everything I introduced today is available on our GitHub. 最后先允许我借这个。 一方感谢一下英斯拉，长年来对我们这个慷慨的支持，使得我们这个项目取得初步的成功。同时，我们有多家这个初创企业，还有大学研究机关在帮助我们逐步的改良这个系统。So that's all for my content today. Thank you very much. 谢谢上次的参与。
So we prepare the goods for 我们为工业用户提供各种智能机器，那么接下来我来介绍一下我的智能机器。那么利用我们身上工业用户，所以我们经常会在一些吉祥环境中进行飞行，比如说这个是在暴雨中。We
test other 300 millimeter power and also
我们在300毫米的降雨量中，我们飞行，那么这个是在火箭中飞行。走，利用exhaust，一下离过来。如果掉下来的话，门会爆炸。
这个车的设计成本很低，可以用于多种用途。
This frame price is under $3,000.
车的价格是低于3000美金。
So you can install any attachment on the top. For example, this is the tube for wire.
你可以在这个车上安装各种设备，这个例子是一个消防管道。So
usually this kind of the vehicle is very expensive, but it's possible to use for any purpose, so it's possible to be lower.
那么这种工业用车平时都是非常昂贵。 但是这个小车的设计非常廉价，可以用于多种用途。
And we apply to the real situation. This is the train, but the fire department start to use this vehicle.
那么这个我们展示的是在消防局的训练场景。
And this picture comes from the drone.
那么这张图是在上空飞行的无人机所拍摄。
So the UAV, the video, the what's going on in the disaster area, and recognized by AI, the human aware or truck aware.
无人机在现场上空飞行，用人工智能识别地面上的目标。
So next is the USB and the UAV.
下面我来介绍一下无人船。
So those vehicles, everything controlled by ArduPilot, which is the cube.
所有这些设备都是由 ArduPilot Cube 来控制。
So this vehicle, the purpose is a research under the water, which is dead bodies.
这个潜水员的目的是在水下航行，找尸体。
This one is the carry the wire for rescue.
那么这艘船后面带着个绳索，用于救援任务。
Anyway, the controller is the pitot, so it's easy to make this kind of autonomous vehicles.
那么，比如我们这个 pitot 来控制制作这样的无人机器，非常简单。
And also, we are making not only the vehicle itself.
我们不仅仅是做无人机器。
Also, we are making the transmitter or the communication to those items.
我们同时也在自己开发无线电和通信设备。
And also, we are making the payload for vehicles. For example, this is a robot arm.
我们同时也在开发这个机械手臂，用于安装到无人机器上使用。
So this arm, the for the UGB, the which is the tip of the chestnuts.
那么这个机械手是用于安装在 wing 上，10节的那个粒子左右。
So this case is the recently the UGB getting very popular in the farm.
最近一段时间无人车在农业当中的应用很受欢迎。
This case is a use vehicle in a strawberry farm.
这个例子是用无人车在草莓大棚中。
So we are using LiDAR and IMU for SRAM and the automatic system.
我们用的 LiDAR 和IMU 进行这个 SRAM 运算。
Even this sensor that connected to the pixel.
所有这些传感器都连接在 pixel 上面。
So right side up picture is the only LiDAR with IMU and walk around, then you can make a 3D the room map.
右上角的图片是我们只用 LiDAR 和 IMU 实现制作的这房间的模型。
Those technology also come from open source. We try to bind those technology with ArduPilot.
所以我们用到的部件都是 open source.
Also, we making 3D mapping by SFM.
同时我用 SFM 系统制作 3D 模型。
Which is take many pictures by drone or UGV.
我们用无人机或者无人车取得很多照片。
So you can make 3D the model.
从照片上复原生成 3D 模型。
So this case is using the AI. Now we are very much focused on the AI, which is deep learning. Because our vehicles don't have the pilot. So instead of pilot, I try to use the AI technologies.
这张图是我们使用人工智能的一个展示。那么我们致力于人工智能的开发。 在无人机上的使用。
We are using the AI technology for search and rescue, and also recently for safety.
我们在无人机上也有人工智能实现这个救援、寻找目标。那么最近我们用人工智能做一些安全方面的。
Recently, the AI, the machine, getting smaller. So, for example, this case is using the Jetson PK2, which is this size.
最近 AI 人工智能系统越来越受关注，同时硬件也成本越来越低。我们只用一个手掌大的Jetson 实现一些功能。
So those machines installed on the back hole and monitoring the camera. Then if something the human there, then stop immediately.
那么刚才这张展示的是在一个吊车后面安装摄像头，然后用人工智能识别，如果有人接近的话，会自动紧急停止。Also,
there are many application for this AI. For example, this one is a lock one human.
那么同时我们又用在无人机上面有各种图像识别方案，这个是一个跟踪系统。Then
follow even turn around the AI recognize which object is a.
那么即使目标移动很快，那么 AI 同时可以跟踪它。
Yeah, this is good for security, and recently I got order from the police department to catch the drone.
那么这个系统主要是用于 安防方面。那么最近我们同时从日本警视厅获得的这个用人工智能捕捉 可疑无人机入侵 系统。
Then when you use AI, the important thing is how to teach the knowledge into the machine.
那么在人工智能开发方面，最重要的是怎么样教给机器？
This case is the teaching the bug, the animal.
这个意思是教给机器什么是野猪。
Just like this, then it's possible. to make annotation data.
我们只需要在浏览器里画出这个目标来，就可以生成训练用的文件。
So this application built in the cloud, which is the AWS.
这个系统是在AWS上面建立。
So the we call Navigent, that is the URL.
这个系统名字叫 Navigent, 网址在上面。
Why we make this interface is very easy to make annotation data by web browser.
我们做这个系统的目的是让大家更简单地生成训练用的文件。
So now handicapped people that help us, that which is a tomato or approved by tablet.
那么现在我们邀请这个残疾人士帮助我们训练人工智能的模型。
And the right side interface is for the segmentation.
右边这张图是做 segmentation 的一个 demo.
Automatically create the edge of the color. Then the customer, the operator, just click the place where the tomato body.
那么系统会自动根据颜色生成一个候补区域，然后机器人标出的人可以简单的、有效的生成训练文件。So
now start to use this interface for the land scenery.
我们现在同样在对这个地面目标做同样的处理。
For example, the river, road, building.
比如说河面，还有地面，还有建筑物。
If something happened in the UAV, if there is a pilot, then the pilot should go to the river.
那比如说无人机发现紧急情况的时候，它应该选择坠落在河里。
Same thing, we going to use AI for that safety.
那么现在这样的工作是由人工来操作的，那么下一步我们想由人工智能取代人类。
So anyway, our advantage is always go to the field with customer. We need experience. For example, this is the deliver the medicine to the island.
我们最大的优势是跟我们的客户真正的到现场去进行测试。 那么这个是运行医药品的一个demo.
So drone itself easy to control this kind of things, but actually in reality there is no operator.
那么这样的演示对于无人机来说是很简单的，但是在现实世界中这个地方没有人来操作。
So we have to prepare the easy interface for.
所以我们要做一个非常简单实用的界面来实现这样的功能。
So those kind of experience is our value.
这样的系统是我们的一个想象。
So I will add on touch to Mr. Kai Yang. So he will explain about more detail how to use AI and how to communicate with other pilot.
那么下面请由我来介绍一下我们的系统怎么样实现人工智能处理。 以及怎么样与ArduPilot进行合作。
Thank you.
谢谢。